I have done it. I did read, I did a narration for Action Bronson once. I played a dolphin for him.
So I love how much you captured this flavor. I literally learned to read with Todd McFarlane comics. That was my whole world growing up.
Oh, wow.
What inspired that 90s Saturday morning cartoon tone?
I don't know, because I didn't grow up with it. You know, like I think I approached it through fresh eyes and through my son's eyes and his care for what his love for all the Avengers, and specifically, you know, Spider-Man, and he also helped me with Bane and stuff like that. You know, so you have the ability to be able to see a child, to have articulated by a child the meaningful and importance of what these characters mean right now, here and now, to my, you know, 13-year-old, whatever, you know, is invigorating in a way that was very rejuvenating. And as a father, you know, you listen, and I can do something about that. So that's important. I think also I love to play. This is such a wonderful sandbox, and character is so full of joy to play. He's cheeky, you know. There's some grown-up elements, very grown-up elements at play. But they're not labored, you know. There's plenty of fun to be had in a deliciously wicked way. And it's a perfect playground to, I suppose, to deal with symbolism, but also to deal with humanity and humor, but also play like a child with a grown-up sensibility.
Yeah, it kind of felt like a mix of that Saturday morning cartoon meets Universal monster movie, and it really lands with a unique tone all around. And I love what it was able to bring to the comic book pantheon. But I have to ask, a lot of people have action figures after them, but not a lot of people have rap tracks. Eminem's Venom, and you, I've heard Tommy Number One mixtapes. I've seen that video of your Dream with the Baby Bjorn. What's it like to have a hip hop track named after you after coming up in the world of hip hop?
That's cool, but it's named after Venom. It's cool, you know.
I mean, it's you, man.
Well, you know, like LP gave me a little shout out among the jewels, and I've had, you know, that makes me beam. If anybody sort of like being connected in any way to that culture and that world is going to obviously bring a big smile to my face, because that's the music that I grew up with and makes me happy, reminds me of my youth and, you know, and the time when I was young, and I still play today to feel young, right? You know what I mean? But so it's really cool. These are heroes, so, you know, like.
What do the people have to do to get you on like a Will Smith or Idris Elba style movie theme track? Like, how do we make that happen?
It's the last thing you want. Be catwailing all over something. So it's probably best I leave that to the professionals. You know what I mean? I am a fan. But I'm strongly rooted in the visual world of maybe a radio play. I have done it. I did read, I did a narration for Action Bronson once. I played a dolphin for him.
So actually, that brings me to our next question. You always have this beautiful vulnerability in these hyper-masculine characters, whether it's Bronson, Tommy Conlin, Stewart, Max.
Oh, I love
Stewart. Always that vulnerability, and I love to see that. Is that what brought you to Eddie? Because he's like the pinnacle of that in the comic book.
I think with Eddie, I saw neurosis and cowardice, but as an art form, in a way that is a sensibility, a vulnerability to protect himself. I think he's also intelligent, that he knows his limits, but he reaches for the cookie jar, he reaches for the flame still. But I think he's an innate, there's something innately cowardly about for me, from my interpretation of Eddie, because when you combine him with the primal confidence of Venom, who has no consequence at all and has a very reasonable and legitimate understanding of what is and is not important and doesn't know boundaries, you have an Eddie who does have boundaries and is trying to legitimize and rationalize boundaries, but it falls away at the seams where you see his hysteria or his neurosis or his fears. And Venom in some ways bolsters up his fears or holds his feet to the flames on those. So he becomes ultimately an anti-hero despite himself, you know. So his true colors come through, but I think innately his nature is to dress back into be more secure and in control of the situation. And he's not in control of the situation even in his real life. It's falling to bits, you know. Rather than leaning into the resentful, I hate Spider-Man, Peter Parker, Venom and Eddie with the spider on the chest that we you know, aperture, which is another way in. I think we used the aperture of the anti-hero and how to make that an interesting double act between the two within the Venomverse, you know. And I think together we are Venom. Clearly they become a superhero when they're together combined, because they bolster up each other's weaknesses and they strengthen each other as a whole. And apart, they kind of suffer their individual, you know, vulnerabilities when they meet the world. Did that make sense?
Thank you so much, Tom. I appreciate all your time and your work, man. Beautiful.